Greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. This is Pastor Raziel McFall, citizen of the Kingdom of God and ambassador of Christ. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, God said, "Let us make man in our image and after our likeness, and let them have dominion." My fellow believer, this was God's primary motivation and purpose for creating man. In the beginning, our God gave mankind kingdom and not a religion. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, Jesus outlines what should be the priorities of man. Every man should busy himself seeking God's kingdom and his righteousness. If the church is to be delivered from the limitations of this world and begin to experience the victory and abundant life that Jesus came to make available to us, we must become more knowledgeable about the kingdom of God and commit ourselves to walking in His righteousness. As you listen to the following message, it is our prayer that you receive insight into God's kingdom and be delivered from the spirit of religion that has held God's people captive for generations. God bless and strengthen you as you listen to the Word of God.
Let the kings worship him today. Let the kings worship him.
As you can see, our overall topic continues to be the kingdom of God. Jesus says a thing to us in Luke chapter 16, verse 16. Jesus said, "The law and the prophets were until John. Since that time, the kingdom of God is preached, and every man presseth into it." Again, Jesus says to us, in Matthew chapter 11, around verse 12, that from the days of John the Baptist till now, the kingdom of heaven suffereth violence, and the violent take it by force. And so we do believe that this is the dispensation where the Lord is revealing the mysteries of his kingdom to the people of God. And so this is why we speak so much about the kingdom of God, because the kingdom of God featured so prominently in the life of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It also features prominently in our lives and in our ministry. And so this is why our overall topic continues to be the kingdom of God. As you can also see, our subtopic tonight is understanding the kingdom of God. This is part 5 of this message, understanding the kingdom of God, part 5. You know, Jesus says a word to us in Matthew chapter 23, I believe it's around verse 13. He said, "Woe unto you Pharisees." He said, "You shut up the kingdom of heaven against men." He said, "You will not enter in yourself, and you will not let the people come in." And so the only way that we as spiritual leaders can enter the kingdom of God more fully is to seek to understand it. And the only way that we can let the people of God into the kingdom is by giving them knowledge and understanding about the kingdom of God. Jesus says another word to us in Matthew chapter 13, around verse 52. He said, "Every scribe who is instructed unto the kingdom of heaven is like unto a man that is an householder, who bringeth forth out of his treasure things new and old." And so we believe that this is the dispensation where we need to be instructed unto the kingdom of heaven. And so we bless the name of Jesus that again we say, because the kingdom of God was the focus of the ministry of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It is also the focus of our ministry. And so we believe that God is going to speak to your heart tonight. You will never see your Bible the same way again. We will see exactly what the Bible is about. We will see exactly what Easter is about. Even as we just came out of the Easter season, as we will refer to tonight, unfortunately, many of us do not know the full story about Easter. Easter is not just about the death of Jesus so that we could go to heaven and escape hell, my fellow believer. We see that Easter was all about restoration of God's kingdom here on this earth. And so again, we say our subtopic tonight is understanding the kingdom of God. This is part 5 of this message. This is where we will get started tonight. Again, we say the kingdom of God has come unto you. We appreciate God for your presence, and we thank God for you. Let's get started with this word, understanding the kingdom of God. This is part 5 of this lesson. Bless the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. So what have we learned thus far? We learned that the Bible is all about a kingdom established. We learned that the Bible is about a kingdom surrendered. We learned that the Bible is about a kingdom recovered or restored, and a kingdom to come. Well, we look at a kingdom established. This was when, of course, God established his kingdom, when he extended his government influence and authority from the invisible realm to the visible realm by creating planet Earth. Then he determined that his children, Adam and Eve, or mankind in general, would rule the earth section of his kingdom. When God said a thing to us in Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 to 28, he said, "Let us make man in our image after our likeness, and let them have dominion." And so what God was doing, God was establishing the government of the earth section of his kingdom. The earth was a colony of the kingdom of heaven, and so this was when God established his kingdom. And of course, we looked at a kingdom surrendered. This was when Adam and Eve allowed themselves to be deceived by the devil who had commandeered the body of a serpent. Because they disobeyed God, because they obeyed the devil, because they were in charge of the earth section of God's kingdom, they effectively committed high treason. They effectively declared independence from the kingdom of heaven. We in the Bahamas understand what it means to declare independence, even as we declared independence from Great Britain. Adam and Eve, representing all mankind, declared independence from God's kingdom when they decided that they no longer wanted God to rule over them. They, in turn, surrendered the kingdom to the devil. We began to look at a kingdom recovered or restored in the third part of this lesson, and this is what we will complete tonight. Bless the Lord. This will be a wonderful teaching, we believe, in Jesus' name. And then finally, we will conclude this teaching with a message about the kingdom to come. And so this is what the Bible is all about, my fellow believer. A kingdom established, a kingdom surrendered, a kingdom recovered and restored, and a kingdom to come. Now, we learned that as a result of Adam and Eve's surrender of the earth section of God's kingdom to Satan through their disobedience and declaration of independence, our God's highest priority is the restoration and reestablishment of his kingdom on the earth. Now, it is unfortunate that we in the body of Christ, we are agents and representatives of God, but we do not fully appreciate the fact that God's highest priority is the restoration and reestablishment of his kingdom on the earth. Like we would say here in the Bahamas, God wants his things back. Adam and Eve turned God's kingdom over to the devil, and God's highest priority is the restoration and reestablishment of his kingdom on the earth. This was the primary purpose of Jesus' mission on the earth, my fellow believer. You know, the Easter season was just concluded in the church, where there was some focus on Jesus' final words. We know we have the tradition, the seven last words of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Oftentimes, we do a teaching or preaching on the topic, "It is finished. It is finished." But what exactly did Jesus mean when he made this statement? What is this "it" that Jesus spoke about? What is this "it" that Jesus declared was finished? Well, remember, one of the reasons why Jesus said that he came. Here it is. This is Luke chapter 19, verse 10. What did Jesus mean when he said, "It is finished"? Did he just mean that mankind is now redeemed and ready to go to heaven when they die? Jesus said a thing here in Luke chapter 19, verse 10. He said, "For the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which was lost." Remember, we looked at this word "save." The word "save" is the Greek word sozo, that's S-O-Z-O. It means to deliver. It means to make whole. It means to get. It means to preserve. But most importantly, this word means to recover and to restore. Let us just say one time that our Greek and Hebrew definitions are being extracted from the Strong's Concordance with Greek and Hebrew dictionary. And so we need to understand that Jesus said that he came to seek and to save, or he came to recover and to restore that which was lost. Christ Jesus came to recover and to restore absolutely everything that Adam and Eve lost, my fellow believer. Jesus Christ is essentially trying to take us back to Eden, because this was the perfect place that God created us in. My fellow believer, again we say, though we just came out of the Easter season, Christ Jesus did not just come to die on the cross so that we could escape hell and go to heaven when we die. We know that this is what the majority of us have been told, even as we grew up in church. Indeed, we thank God for the blessed hope of living with God and Christ throughout eternity in the New Jerusalem after the return of Christ. But my fellow believer, this was not the primary focus of Jesus' mission on the earth. This is just one of the many benefits that became available to us as a result of Jesus' mission. For generations, the church has made this benefit the purpose for Jesus' coming. But Christ Jesus came primarily to restore God's kingdom, or his reign, or his sovereign rulership, or his governing influence on the earth. This is why the prophet Isaiah said, according to Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, Isaiah said, "Unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder." When we think about his shoulder, shoulder is the Hebrew word shechem. This is speaking to Jesus' duty, or his burden, or his task, or his assignment, or his work. My fellow believer, Jesus' task was about government. Jesus came to restore God's kingdom government on the earth, because Adam and Eve turned the government of the earth over to the devil. And so Jesus came to defeat that devil so that God's kingdom could be restored on the earth. Jesus came, my fellow believer, to bring the earth back under God's kingdom government as it was in the beginning before Adam and Eve rebelled. Now, this included man's immediate reconciliation to the Father and restoration of man's access to sonship in God's family and citizenship in his heavenly kingdom. Jesus also came to provide mankind with the keys of the kingdom so that they could reflect the culture and manifest the power and authority of the kingdom and gain access to the rights, privileges, advantages, and benefits associated with their sonship and citizenship, and experience life and life more abundantly, or the quality of life under God's government, both now and throughout eternity. Remember, Jesus said a word to us in St. John chapter 10, verse 10. He said, "I am come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly." And so Jesus came to make you a son of God, and he came to make you a citizen of his heavenly kingdom. He came to appoint you as an ambassador. He came to reconnect you with his heavenly kingdom so that you could experience the quality of life under God's government. Again, we say this is not just now, but this is throughout eternity when we live with him, when the tabernacle of God is set up with men in the New Jerusalem in the age to come after the return of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Again, Jesus came so that we could gain access to the rights and privileges, benefits and advantages associated with our sonship and our citizenship, and we are now able to experience the quality of life under God's government. This is why Christ Jesus said a word to us here in Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. He said, "But seek ye what? First, the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you." What did Jesus tell us should be the priority in our lives? He said, "First, the kingdom of God." This word "first" is the Greek word proton. It means first in time, place, order, and importance. And so Jesus said that the kingdom of God should be first in our lives. Now, in our minds as believers, we think the kingdom of God is heaven. We will see tonight that the kingdom of God is about the rule of God. It's about the reign of God. It's about coming under God's governing influence and sovereign rulership, my fellow believer. Jesus said that we should seek to get under God's government. We should seek to learn what it means to live under God's government, and we should stay in right alignment with God's government. This is what he means by not only seeking the kingdom, but also the righteousness of God. And so Jesus said that the kingdom and righteousness of God should be the priorities in our lives. And so again, I say, one of these days, we're going to look into our Bible and we're going to be obedient to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. You know, Jesus' mission of restoring God's kingdom government on the earth also included restoration of man's empowerment and ability to fulfill their dominion mandate or assignment and to function as the agency for God's government on the earth. Remember, the very first gift that God gave to man in the beginning was dominion. God said, "Let us make man and let them have dominion." And so Jesus came to seek and to save. He came to restore and to recover absolutely everything that was lost. And so Jesus' mission of restoring God's kingdom government on the earth also included restoration of man's empowerment and ability to fulfill their dominion mandate or assignment and to function as the agency for God's government on the earth. We need to understand that Jesus' mission is about a lot more than just preparing us to go to heaven when we die. In fact, Jesus prayed for us, I believe it's in St. John chapter 17, around verse 15. He said, "Father, I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world, but that thou shouldest keep them from the evil." And so, my fellow believer, Jesus' mission was to bring and to return the kingdom of God and the governing influence and sovereign rulership and the reign of God and the culture of the kingdom of heaven to the earth. This is why the very first thing that he asked us to pray for, as we said a little earlier, as outlined in Matthew chapter 6, verse 10, is, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven." And so we praise the name of Jesus for Jesus' mission of restoring our ability to fulfill our dominion mandate or assignment on the earth. Now, though not a particular focus of the church today, restoration of God's kingdom on the earth was the primary purpose and focus of the life and ministry of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Dr. Miles Monroe was trying to get us to focus on this a long time ago, but we praise God that it's never too late to get this job done. And so again, we say, though not a particular focus of the church generally today, restoration of God's kingdom on the earth was the primary purpose and focus of Jesus' life and the ministry. This is why John the Baptist, the man who came to prepare Jesus' way before him, came with an initial public declaration as outlined in Matthew chapter 3, verse 2. Remember now, John was the one who came to prepare Jesus' way before him. He was the forerunner of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. But this is how the Bible introduced John's ministry. Matthew chapter 3, verse 2, John came preaching, "Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Jesus' focus was the kingdom, my fellow believer. This also explains Jesus' initial public declaration as outlined in Matthew chapter 4, verse 17. John came preaching about the kingdom, and as soon as John was placed into prison, Jesus began to preach, and Jesus began to preach, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Even as both John and Jesus Christ proclaimed the kingdom's arrival in their initial public declarations, Jesus gave specific instructions to his disciples as he sent them out. Here it is. This is Matthew chapter 10, verse 7. As Jesus sent out his 12 disciples for the first time, he told them, "And as ye go, preach this message. Preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand." And so Jesus instructed the 12 disciples to go out and let people know that the kingdom of heaven has arrived, that the kingdom of heaven is now accessible to mankind through Christ Jesus, and that they could manifest the culture, power, and authority through mighty signs and wonders. Every time a blinded eye was opened, every time a lame person walked, God was just confirming the arrival, presence, and operation of his kingdom. And so Jesus told his disciples to go and preach, letting people know that the kingdom of God is here. Could it be that we are not experiencing a greater manifestation of power and authority in the church because God wants to confirm the word? He wants to confirm that his kingdom is here by manifesting the culture, power, and authority of his kingdom. I wonder what we do with scriptures like this in the body of Christ. And again, we say consistent with Jesus's focus and the primary purpose for which he came to the earth. What was the very first thing that he asked us to pray for? Well, here it is in Matthew chapter 6, verse 10. "Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven." And so again, we say Christ Jesus did not come to establish a religion, and he did not just come to die on the cross so that we can go to heaven and escape hell. Christ Jesus came to reestablish God's kingdom on the earth. We said that as part of Jesus' mission of reestablishing and restoring God's kingdom on the earth, it was necessary for Satan, who had illegally taken custody of the government of the earth, to be defeated. Now we learned that Satan's defeat was executed through the cross of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Again, we say we just came out of the Easter season and we need a better understanding of the full work of the cross of Calvary. And so the devil was defeated through the cross of Calvary, whereby Jesus Christ paid the ransom for mankind. Jesus Christ used the power of the cross and the power of his death and resurrection to take possession of the keys of death, hell, and the grave. He also demonstrated dominion over the devil's most potent weapon, which was death, my fellow believer. Here's what Paul said about Jesus' defeat of the enemy in his letter to the Hebrews. This is Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14. "And so Jesus' death on the cross was not just about you prepared to go to heaven in the sweet by and by. Jesus came to defeat that devil so that his Father's kingdom could be restored and recovered and reestablished on the earth, my fellow believer." This was his primary mission. Paul said a thing here to us in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14. He said, "For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same." He's speaking about Christ Jesus now. Why did Jesus take part of flesh and blood? "That through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil." And so Jesus died on the cross to destroy that devil, my fellow believer. This is the bruising of the enemy's head as prophesied by God in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. Remember, God told that devil, that a seed of this woman was coming to bruise his head even as he bruised his heel. That devil bruised Jesus' heel on Calvary, but Jesus used that same tool of the cross to bruise the devil's head. Christ Jesus' mission was to destroy the devil so that God's kingdom on the earth could be restored and recover. It was necessary for the devil to be defeated because Adam and Eve delivered control or custody of the kingdoms or government of the world to him as a result of their declaration of independence by their disobedience and rebellion. Now, during his temptation of Christ Jesus, the devil flaunted his most prized possession or his goods. Here's part of Luke's account of Jesus' temptation. Here's what that devil said as he tempted Christ Jesus. He was confirming that he was in possession of the kingdoms of this world. This is Luke chapter 4, verses 5 to 6. The Bible says, "And the devil, taking him up into an high mountain, what did he show Jesus? He shewed unto him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time." The devil showed Jesus the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. Then the devil confirmed that it was the kingdoms of this world that were conveyed to him. They were transferred to him through Adam and Eve's rebellion, high treason, and declaration of independence. Here it is in the very next verse. This is Luke chapter 4, verse 6. The Bible says, "And the devil said unto him, all this power, all this authority will I give thee, and the glory of them. Why? For that is delivered unto me, and to whomsoever I will, I give it." And so the devil was bragging about the fact that Adam and Eve had delivered the kingdoms or the government of the earth over to him through their rebellion and disobedience. In this exercise here, the devil was letting Jesus know what his prized possession was. What was that devil's prized possession? Well, the devil or strong man's goods or his prized possession was the ability and empowerment to exercise dominion and authority on the earth or over the kingdoms of the world. And by so doing, the devil was empowered to impose his will, intent, purpose, and culture over the lives of all people on the earth. This was that devil's prized possession. This is what he was after. He wanted to be in charge. Remember, he tried unsuccessfully to execute a coup in heaven, and then he was cast out of heaven. And then he executed a successful coup on the earth because he deceived Eve, who eventually gave Adam to eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And by so doing, and as a result thereof, the devil took control. He took custody of the government of the earth. This is why it's the devil's culture that prevails on the earth today. But as Jesus defeated the enemy through the cross, Jesus also stripped him of his goods. And so the church needs to understand that Jesus' mission was not just about preparing us to go to heaven when we die. We just saw Paul said in Hebrews chapter 2 verse 14 that through death Christ Jesus destroyed that devil. Jesus came to strip the enemy of his goods. He came to spoil his goods. He came to take his prized possession from him. Jesus did this through the cross, my fellow believer. Now Jesus implied that this was part of his mission, even as he responded to the Pharisees who had accused him of casting out devils by Beelzebub. Here's what Jesus said. This is Matthew chapter 12, verse 29. Jesus said, "Or else, how can one enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods, except he first bind the strong man, and then he will spoil his house?" Jesus was here foreshadowing his mission. He came to spoil the enemy's goods. He came to bind that strong man. He came to take that prized possession that we just saw, the ability to execute dominion and authority over the earth from that devil. And we will see that he left it with the church. Well, we don't want to get ahead of ourselves, but this was Jesus's primary mission, my fellow believer. Jesus's mission was not just about preparing you to go to heaven when you die. Jesus came to restore his Father's kingdom government on the earth. Now, as part of the process of fulfilling his primary mission of restoring God's kingdom on the earth, Christ Jesus defeated the strong man so that he could strip him of his goods. In his letter to the Colossians, Paul lets us know that this spoiling of the enemy's goods was completed through the cross. Here it is. Again, this is Colossians chapter 2, verse 15. We just came out of the Easter season, but we do believe that we in the body of Christ need to be reintroduced even to Easter and to the mission of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and the power and the purpose of the cross. Here's what Paul said to us in Colossians chapter 2, verse 15. Paul said, "And having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a shew of them openly, triumphing over them in it." The "it" here is the cross of Calvary. And so the Bible teaches that Christ Jesus spoiled the principalities and powers, and he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. Again, we say the it here is the cross of Calvary. The cross was the instrument used by God and Christ to bruise that devil's head. Through his death on the cross and subsequent victorious resurrection, Christ Jesus defeated the devil. He broke the power and authority of the kingdom of darkness off the lives of any person that accepts his plan of salvation. And he bound that strong man so that he could spoil his goods. Now the Bible says here that having spoiled principalities and powers, let's take a closer look at this word spoil. According to Oxford.com, the word spoil means to diminish or destroy the value of. According to Dictionary.com, the word spoil means to plunder, pillage, or rob. According to Merriam-Webster, the word spoil means to damage seriously or ruin. And so, my fellow believer, through his powerful life and victorious death on the cross, Christ Jesus diminished, devalued, seriously damaged, ruined, plundered, pillaged, and robbed principalities and powers. And so we need to understand the full work, the full gamut of what Jesus did on the cross, my fellow believer. Now here's something that we need to consider. Even though Jesus was the Son of God, he did not receive dominion and authority over the earth until after he defeated the enemy on the cross and God delivered the kingdom to him after his resurrection. Again, this may be hard to believe, but even though Jesus was the Son of God, he did not receive dominion and authority over the earth until after he defeated the enemy on the cross and God delivered the kingdom to him after his resurrection. The kingdom or dominion over the earth could only be delivered to Christ Jesus after he defeated the enemy through his death on the cross. I know that this might be hard for some to believe, but here's what Paul said to us through his letter to the Philippians. Even though Christ Jesus demonstrated power and authority over demons and he healed sick people whilst he was on the earth, he did this because of the presence and the power of Holy Spirit that was in his life. But Jesus did not receive dominion and authority over the earth until after he defeated that devil. And we will show you this from the Word of God. Here's what Paul said to us through his letter to the Philippians. This is Philippians chapter 2, verses 8 to 11. This is why we in the body of Christ, we need to understand exactly what Jesus Christ was doing. He was not just preparing us to go to heaven when we die, when he died on the cross. Here's what Paul says to us through his letter to the Philippians. He said, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself. Of course, he's speaking about Christ Jesus, and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. And so Christ Jesus humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Look at what the Bible says in the very next verse. Wherefore, this word wherefore is the Greek word dio. It means therefore or consequently. And so Jesus' exaltation was as a consequence or as a result of the fact that he humbled himself and he became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. The Bible says wherefore or therefore or consequently. God also hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name. Notice Jesus was given kingdom, dominion, and authority over the earth only after and because he defeated that devil through his death on the cross. Then Paul described Jesus' exaltation in the very next verse. This is Philippians chapter 2, verse 10. That at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow of things in heaven and the things in earth and the things under the earth. And in verse 11, Paul concluded by saying, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Jesus' exaltation meant God's exaltation and the restoration of the kingdom or rule of God on the earth. Here's Paul again letting us know that Jesus was exalted only after he defeated the enemy through the cross. This is Ephesians chapter 1, verses 19 to 23. Look at what Paul says to us through his letter to the Ephesians. Again, we say, we know that it might be hard for you to believe, but Jesus Christ had to defeat that devil on the cross, and then we will see that thereafter, and as a consequence thereof, God gave him power and dominion over the earth realm. Here's what Paul says to us through his letter to the Ephesians. The Bible says, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe, according to the working of his mighty power. And so Paul began to speak about the working of God's mighty power. Here's what he said in verse 20 of Ephesians chapter 1, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead. It was only after he was raised from the dead and then he was set at his own right hand in the heavenly places. In verse 21, Paul says, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come. And so we begin to see that Jesus was set at the right hand of God after God raised him from the dead. This is when God set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places. Then Paul concluded here in verses 22 and 23 of Ephesians 1. The Bible says, and hath put all things under his feet and gave him to be the head over all things to the church. Again, this only happened after Jesus died on the cross and he defeated that devil through the power of the cross and he went down to hell because he had our sins on him. You know, the Bible says that the wages of sin is death. Christ Jesus could not die. Why? Because he had no sin. Remember, Isaiah said that he was marred more than any other man. And so Jesus should have died from the whipping that he received, but he could not die. Why? Because the Bible says the wages of sin is death, and Jesus had no sin. And so what did God do? God took Jesus' righteousness and he put it on us. And then he took our sins and put it on Jesus. And so because Jesus had sin on him, then he could die. This is the only way Jesus could die. The only way Jesus could die is if he had sinned, because the wages of sin is death. God took our sins and placed it upon Christ Jesus. And because Jesus had our sins, because he died with our sins on him, Jesus could not go to heaven. Jesus went down to the lower parts of the earth. He went down to hell. This was all a part of God's strategy. My fellow believer, he went down there and he beat up that devil and he snatched the keys of death, hell, and the grave. This was all a part of the strategy. Jesus said, no man has taken my life. I have the power to lay it down and I have the power to take it up again. And so God placed our sins upon Christ Jesus so that he could qualify to die. And so when he died, because he had our sins, he went down to hell. And so this was part of God's plan, my fellow believer. Jesus went down and beat up that devil. And because he defeated that devil through the cross of Calvary, through his death on the cross, God has highly exalted him. God had set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named. Jesus Christ only received this power and dominion and authority after he defeated that devil on the cross.
But Paul says here in Ephesians chapter 1, verses 22 to 23, and hath put all things under his feet and gave him to be the head of all things to the church. In verse 23, Paul says, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. And so because of his death on the cross, God exalted him, placed him at his own right hand in the heavenly places, and put all things under his feet.
Question is, when exactly did this exaltation or transfer of kingdom or dominion and authority to Jesus from God take place? When exactly did this take place? Well, here are a few things that happened after Jesus' resurrection. Firstly, here's Jesus' encounter with Mary near the garden tomb. Here's what happened shortly after Jesus' resurrection. Here's what the Bible says. This is St. John chapter 20, verses 16 to 17. Jesus said unto her, Mary. She turned herself and saith unto him, Rabboni, which is to say, Master. Look at what Christ Jesus said to Mary in St. John chapter 20, verse 17. Jesus said unto her, touch me not. Why? For I have not yet ascended to my Father, but go to my brethren and say unto them, I ascend unto my Father and your Father, and to my God and your God. And so we need to take note of the fact that Mary could not touch Christ Jesus. Why? Because he declared that he had not yet ascended unto his Father. But here's something that happened just 8 days later. This is St. John chapter 20, verses 26 to 27. And after 8 days, again, his disciples were within, and Thomas with them. Then came Jesus, the doors being shut, and stood in the midst, and said, peace be unto you. Look at what happened in verse 27 of St. John 20. Then saith he to Thomas, reach hither thy finger, and behold my hands, and reach hither thy hand, and thrust it into my side, and be not faithless, but believing. So while Mary was not allowed to touch Christ Jesus, now Jesus is inviting Thomas to touch him and to inspect his hands and his side. And so something had to happen in between Jesus' encounter with Mary and Thomas. What happened in between these two events? Mary could not touch him, he said, because he had not yet ascended to his Father. Now he's inviting Brother Thomas to touch him just 8 days later. He had to have already ascended to his Father, my fellow believer. Again, we say that the primary reason that Mary could not touch him was the fact that he had not yet ascended to his Father. to help us to understand exactly what happened in between Jesus' meetings with Mary and Thomas, we need to understand a few things. Firstly, there's the title that Jesus used to identify himself on the earth some 82 times in the four Gospels. What is this title? Jesus called himself the Son of Man some 82 times in the four Gospels that chronicle his life. And so I want you to hold on to that fact. We're going somewhere, my fellow believer. We're going to show you exactly what happened in between Jesus' meetings with Mary and with Thomas. And so here it is. Again, hold on to this fact. Christ Jesus, as you know, he said Son of Man. He always referred to himself as Son of Man. This was whilst he was on the earth, because unto us a child was born, unto us a son is given. And so he called himself Son of Man. Hold on to that fact, we say. Additionally, the Bible indicates that Jesus uses clouds to commute between heaven and earth. Again, the Bible indicates that Jesus uses clouds to commute between heaven and earth. And so in the Bahamas, we might call a taxi. In America, they might call an Uber. But Christ Jesus, whenever he wanted to commute between heaven and earth, he would always call a cloud. He would ride upon the clouds. Here's what Isaiah said. This is Isaiah chapter 19, verse 1. We're going somewhere. I'm going to let you know when Christ Jesus received this kingdom power and authority and what happened between his meetings with Mary and Thomas. Isaiah said, "Behold, the Lord rideth upon a swift cloud." And so we begin to see that Christ Jesus uses clouds to commute between heaven and earth. To confirm this, remember how Jesus ascended up to heaven. This is Acts chapter 1, verse 9. "While they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight." And remember how Jesus will return to the earth. This is Matthew chapter 24, verse 30. "And they shall see the Son of Man coming," what? "In the clouds of heaven, with power and great glory." And so Jesus used the cloud to go up to heaven, and he will use a cloud to come back down the second time. And so we said that Jesus called himself Son of Man, and Jesus uses clouds to commute between heaven and earth. What's the significance of these two things, and what do they have to do with what happened between Jesus' encounters with Mary and Thomas? Remembering that Mary could not touch Jesus until he had ascended to the Father, Daniel let us know exactly what happened in between these two events. Here it is in Daniel chapter 7, verses 13 to 14. Remember that Jesus called himself the Son of Man, and he commutes between heaven and earth on the clouds. Here's what Daniel saw many generations before. The Bible says in Daniel 7, 13, "I saw in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man," there's that title that Jesus used 82 times, the Bible says, "came with the clouds of heaven, and came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him." And so the clouds took Jesus up into heaven. He told Mary that you can't touch me. Why? Because I have not yet ascended up to my Father. And so Daniel saw exactly what happened in between those two meetings. Daniel saw one like the Son of Man. His vision was therefore to be fulfilled after the Word became flesh and assumed the position of Son of Man. Daniel also referred to the clouds, which are the vehicles that Jesus uses to commute between heaven and earth. Then what happened according to Daniel's vision? Here's what happened in the very next verse. This is Daniel chapter 7, verse 14. "And there was given him dominion and glory and a kingdom, that all people, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion, which shall not pass away, and his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed." Daniel is here describing what happened in between Jesus' meetings with Mary and Thomas. Thomas could touch him. Why? Because Jesus had already ascended to his Father, having defeated the enemy. And as a result of Jesus' defeat of the enemy through the cross, the Father could convey or transfer the kingdom to him. And so again, we say it was only after Jesus died on the cross and he rose again from the dead. Then he went up to heaven. He attended the ceremony that Daniel saw many generations before. And this was when God gave him dominion and glory and a kingdom that all people and nations and languages should serve and obey him. This is why just before his ascension, after Jesus returned from heaven, just before he left the earth, Jesus was able to make this declaration as outlined here in Matthew chapter 28, verse 18. He said, "Now I run things now." He said, "All power is given unto me, both in heaven and in earth." Notice Jesus made this declaration. Why? Because it was not always the case. He said, "Listen, all power is now given unto me, both in heaven and in earth." Jesus could make this declaration. Why? because he had bruised the enemy's head on the cross and he received the kingdom from his Father. My fellow believer, Jesus always had power and authority and dominion in the heavenlies, but he had to defeat that devil on the cross so that he could receive that dominion and authority over the earth. And so Jesus's declaration here confirmed another transfer of the custody of the kingdom. Remember, the Bible says that in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, and so at that time God was in charge of the government of both heaven and earth. Then God made a declaration. He said, let us make man. He issued a royal decree. He said, let us make man and let them have dominion over the earth and over everything on the earth. And so by so doing, God transferred the custody of the kingdom to mankind. He transferred it to Adam and Eve. Through their disobedience, rebellion, high treason, and declaration of independence, Adam and Eve transferred the kingdom to the devil. Remember, we just saw in Luke chapter 4, verses 5 to 6, he showed them the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time, and he said, all this was delivered unto me. And so Adam and Eve transferred the custody of the kingdom, or the control of the governing influence and sovereign rulership of the earth, over to the devil. But we praise God that Christ Jesus came down and he defeated that devil on the cross. And as a result of the defeat of the devil, God was able to transfer that kingdom back to Christ Jesus. Remember, God still owns the earth. The Bible says the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. This is why Christ Jesus came, my fellow believer. He came to defeat that devil. And as a result of the defeat of the devil, God was able to transfer that kingdom back to Christ Jesus. During that ceremony that we just saw, that Daniel saw, Christ Jesus received the custody of the kingdom, the right power and authority to exercise dominion over the earth. This is why he said, all power is given unto me, both in heaven and in earth. What is the next phase of the custody of the kingdom? Well, remember that God was concerned that in his sinful state, man would have access to the tree of life
and live forever.
So here's what God did after man's rebellion and declaration of independence. This is Genesis chapter 3, verse 24. The Bible says, so he, that's God, he drove out the man, and he placed at the east of the Garden of Eden cherubims and a flaming sword, which turned every way to keep the way of the tree of life. Mankind was physically driven from his home in the Garden of Eden. But more significantly and importantly, something else happened spiritually. Let's take a closer look at these words, drove out. The Bible says that God drove them out. Drove out is the Hebrew word garash. That's G-A-R-A-S-H. It means to thrust out. It means to remove from a possession. But most importantly, the words drove out means to expatriate or to divorce. Man was divorced from his God. There was a broken relationship. And because of this disconnection from the source of his life, power, and authority, man was no longer able to carry out his dominion mandate or assignment. Man was also expatriated from his spiritual home in the kingdom of heaven, and man was exiled into the kingdom of darkness with the devil as his new leader. Indeed, each and every one of us were born in the kingdom of darkness because and by virtue of the rebellion and declaration of independence of Adam and Eve. Now, through his defeat of the enemy and the utilization of his blood to pay the ransom for mankind, Jesus made it possible for man to be delivered from the kingdom of darkness and transferred or translated or repatriated into the kingdom of light or the kingdom of heaven. Again, this is the good news, my fellow believer. Through his defeat of the enemy and the utilization of his blood to pay the ransom for mankind, Jesus made it possible for us to be delivered from the kingdom of darkness and transferred, translated, or repatriated into the kingdom of light or the kingdom of heaven. Here's how Matthew described man's position, even as he quoted Isaiah chapter 9, verse 2. Matthew said here in Matthew chapter 4, verse 16, the people which sat in darkness saw great light, and to them which sat in the region and shadow of death, light is sprung up. Each and every one of us were born in the region and the shadow of death and darkness. What is this word region? The word region is the Greek word kora. It means empty expanse. It means territory. It means coast and country and land. And so because of Adam and Eve's rebellion, man was spiritually exiled into the region or territory or land or country or kingdom or dominion of darkness. This is again, we say, where each and every one of us was born. This is why Christ Jesus said a word to us here in St. John chapter 12, verse 46. He said, I am come a light into the world, that whosoever believeth on me should not abide in darkness. And so we need to understand that Christ Jesus came to deliver us from that kingdom of darkness. Paul the apostle also spoke about our deliverance from the region of darkness. Here it is in Colossians chapter 1, verses 12 to 13. Paul said, giving thanks unto the Father, which hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light. Look at verse 13. Who hath delivered us from the power of darkness and hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son. Christ Jesus made it possible for every man who accepts his plan of salvation through faith to be delivered from the kingdom of darkness and be repatriated as fully naturalized citizens of God's heavenly kingdom. And what else did Jesus do for mankind? Well, we saw a little earlier in this message how Jesus spoke about entering the strong man's house with the objective of spoiling his goods. Here's what Jesus said. This is Matthew chapter 12, verse 29. And so the saints of God need to know, not only did Jesus make it possible for us to be delivered from the kingdom or a region of darkness and be translated or transferred into the kingdom of heaven, Jesus also came to do some other things for us. Matthew 12, 29. Jesus said, or else how can one enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods, except he first bind the strong man, and then he will spoil his house. We said that Jesus came to defeat the strong man so that he could strip him of his goods. Remember, his goods were generally the ability to exercise dominion and authority in the earth realm, because he possessed the kingdom by virtue of Adam and Eve's rebellion. But Luke lets us know what Jesus did with the goods or the spoils that he took from that devil. Again, we say, Luke let us know what Jesus did with the goods or the spoils that he took from that devil. This is Luke chapter 11, verses 20 to 22. Matthew didn't let us in on this secret, but here's what Luke said. But if I with the finger or the Spirit of God cast out devils, no doubt the kingdom of God is come unto you. Here it is in verse 21. When a strong man armed keepeth his palace, his goods are in peace. Here it is in verse 22. This is the secret that Matthew did not reveal to us. The Bible says, but when a stronger than he cometh upon him and overcome him, he taketh from him all his armor wherein he trusted and divideth the spoils. And so Matthew didn't let us know that Jesus divideth the spoils. Paul let us know in Colossians 2:15 that Jesus Christ spoiled the principalities and powers and made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in the cross. Matthew let us know that Jesus came to spoil the goods of the strong man, but he didn't let us know that Jesus divideth the spoils. Matthew didn't let us in on this secret. Not only did Christ Jesus come as the stronger one to overcome the devil, spoil principalities and powers and to take his goods, but the Bible also teaches that the greater one, Christ Jesus, willingly divideth the spoils. What is this word divideth? Well, the word divideth is the Greek word diadidomi. This means to give throughout a crowd. It means to deal out. It means to deliver over to a successor, my Lord. It means to distribute. It means to give and to share. And so Christ Jesus was not selfish. He spoiled the principalities and power. He took the power and authority from that devil through his death on the cross. But Luke let us know that he divided the spoil. He gave it throughout a crowd. He dealt it to us, my fellow believer. He delivered it over to his successors. Remember, Jesus said that he was the light of the world while he was in the world. But then he said that we, the body of Christ, we are now the light of the world, and so we are Jesus's successors. He told us to occupy until he comes. And so when Jesus defeated the enemy and spoiled his goods, he therefore distributed and shared that authority with the saints of God so that they could continue with the work that Jesus started, and so that they would be empowered to maintain and advance God's kingdom agenda on the earth. Not only did Jesus defeat that devil, but he divided the spoil, my fellow believer. You remember what Jesus said? This is Matthew chapter 28, verse 18. Jesus said, I run things now. All powers given or delivered unto me, both in heaven and in earth. Jesus declared that he possessed the kingdom, or the right power and authority to reign and to rule, exercise dominion, sovereignty, and governing influence over both heaven and earth. Remember, we saw that he received this authority and dominion in that ceremony that Daniel saw many generations ago. Remember that Jesus Christ, he always had this power in heaven. But though he exercised dominion over devils through the power of Holy Spirit while he was on the earth, Jesus only received all power and dominion in the earth realm after he defeated that devil on the cross. And again, we say he attended that ceremony that Daniel saw, as we just discussed a little earlier. But we want to focus on something that the devil said as he tempted Christ Jesus. The devil showed Jesus all the kingdoms of the world, and then he said here in Luke chapter 4, verse 6, All this power will I give thee, and the glory of them, for that is delivered unto me. And so this is what the devil said as he tempted Christ Jesus. But this is not the only thing he said. What else did that devil say? He said, and to whomsoever I will, I give it. And so the devil was letting Jesus know that because he possessed the kingdom at that time, he said that the kingdom was delivered unto him. Of course, this was through the rebellion of Adam and Eve. But the devil said that to whomsoever he will, he give it. And so if the devil, as possessor of the kingdom, had the
ability
to give kingdom authority to whomever he wanted, when Christ Jesus took possession of the kingdom, Jesus was also able to give the kingdom to whomsoever he wanted. The devil said, unto whomsoever I will, I give it. And so if the devil had that right, benefit, and privilege after Jesus came back and he declared, all power is given unto me, after Jesus received power and dominion and authority over the earth realm, if the devil had the right to deliver the kingdom to whomsoever he wanted, Jesus Christ also had that right, my fellow believer. And guess what? Jesus decided to give the kingdom to his disciples, including you and I. Yes, what Jesus said to his disciples just before his arrest and crucifixion. This is Luke chapter 22, verse 29. Jesus said, and I appoint or deliver unto you a kingdom, as my Father hath appointed unto me. And so remember, we saw when his Father appointed unto him that kingdom that Daniel saw, my fellow believer. But Jesus said, even as my Father hath appointed unto me a kingdom, I now appoint unto you. He's speaking to his disciples. He's speaking to you. He's speaking to me. He has also delivered unto us the kingdom now. Now, my fellow believer, whilst Jesus remains Lord and Master of the kingdom through his life, his death, his resurrection, and the release of Holy Spirit, he made the kingdom available and accessible to the saints of God. I believe with all my heart that this is the missing link in the body of Christ. The saints of God, we the church, we do not realize that Jesus Christ has delivered unto us the kingdom. Jesus took power and authority from that devil because he defeated him on the cross. God gave him the kingdom, and Jesus, in turn, he delivered, he divided up the spoil, he gave the kingdom to the saints of God. But we, unfortunately, are just sitting and waiting and looking up and hoping to go to heaven in the sweet by and by. But we don't understand that we can now manifest the culture, power, and authority of God's kingdom right here and right now, because Jesus has already delivered unto us the kingdom, my fellow believer. Remember that in the Garden of Eden, because God initially gave man dominion over the earth realm, Satan's promotion to the seat of authority resulted in man's demotion or his removal from the seat of authority. Again, because God initially gave man dominion over the earth realm, Satan's promotion to the seat of authority resulted in man's demotion or man's removal from the seat of authority. But we got good news for you tonight, my fellow believer. Romans chapter 11, verse 29. The Bible says, for the gifts and calling of God are without repentance. Again, Paul said to us through his letter to the Romans, the gifts and the calling of God are without repentance. And if we don't understand what Paul is saying, here's the New King James version of this same verse. Romans chapter 11, verse 29. Paul was saying, for the gifts and calling of God are irrevocable. Again, for the gifts and calling of God are irrevocable. And so, my fellow believer, because the gifts and calling of God are irrevocable, if we could dare to get in right alignment with God, we would be restored to our position of dominion. And so through the power of Holy Spirit and the cross, Christ Jesus spoiled principalities and powers. He destroyed, he judged and cast out that devil, and he also destroyed his works. Again, through the power of Holy Spirit and the cross, Christ Jesus spoiled the principalities and powers, and he destroyed and he judged and he cast that devil out, and he also destroyed his works. And so because the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable, the devil's defeat meant man's restoration to his position of sonship, citizenship, dominion, and authority. If he accepted God's plan of salvation and came under God's government one more time. And so the gifts and calling of God are irrevocable. And so because Jesus defeated that devil on the cross, because we as believers, we willingly submitted ourselves to God's government when we declared that Jesus Christ is Lord, when we accepted him as our Lord and Savior, when we accepted his plan of salvation, my fellow believer, the gifts and calling of God were restored to us. The first dominion was restored to us, my fellow believer. This is what the church needs to understand. We need to understand that Jesus did so much more than just prepare us to go to heaven when we die. We have power and authority right here and right now. In fact, Paul lets us know in Romans chapter 5, verse 17, that because we receive the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness, we are now empowered to reign in life through Christ Jesus. And so remembering that Jesus said that he came to seek and to save or to restore and to recover that which was lost. For a few bites of a fruit, man forfeited, surrendered, and lost his access to two primary things. Again, for a few bites of a fruit, man forfeited, surrendered, and lost his access to two primary things. Firstly, man forfeited and lost his relationship or his sonship with the King of Heaven, which provided them with their kingdom citizenship. Man's relationship with the Father and their citizenship in the kingdom of heaven are what provided them with access to the rights, privileges, benefits, and resources of the kingdom of heaven. Now, what other primary thing did man lose? Well, man lost his ability and authority to execute their dominion assignment or mandate on the earth. Remember, God said, "Let us make man in our image and after our likeness, and let them have dominion." This was the first gift that God gave man. And so man lost their ability and authority to execute their dominion, mandate, or assignment on the earth. Now, because they lost God's Holy Spirit, who was the source of their life, empowerment, and authority, mankind could no longer execute their dominion, mandate on the earth. But in his conversation with the 70 apostles, after their successful evangelistic mission, Jesus lets us know that restoration of these key blessings from God was at hand. Here's what happened. Again, this is Jesus speaking to the 70 apostles after they returned from a successful evangelistic mission. Look at what Jesus said to them. Luke chapter 10, verses 17 to 18. The Bible says, "And the 70 returned again with joy, saying, 'Lord, even the devils are subject unto us through thy name.'" But look at what Jesus said to them. This is Luke chapter 10, verse 18. "And he said unto them, 'I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven.'" My Lord, Jesus said, "I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven." Now, what is this word heaven? Well, this word heaven is the Greek word Uranos. That's O-U-R-A-N-O-S. This means elevated position. This means seat of authority. This means power. And so Jesus began to make this declaration that Satan was falling from his elevated position. This is the position that he stole through deception in the Garden of Eden. Now, this is why Jesus Christ came. He came to beat up that devil so that his Father's kingdom could be restored on the earth. And so Jesus began to declare the defeat of that devil. He said he beheld Satan as lightning fall from his elevated position, from his seat of authority, and from his power. This was the seed of the woman bruising the serpent's head and removing him from the position of authority he stole, as promised by God in the Garden of Eden in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. But we in the church need to understand the fullness of what Christ Jesus came to do. My fellow believer, for many years, I thought that Jesus came primarily to die on the cross so that I could go to heaven and escape hell. But the body of Christ needs to understand, Jesus came to seek and to save. He came to restore and to recover absolutely everything that Adam and Eve lost. The first thing that Adam and Eve lost, they lost the image and likeness of God, but they also lost their ability to exercise dominion. This was the first gift that God gave to mankind. Then Jesus went on to confirm restoration of the two primary things that we just look at, the two primary things that man lost. Here it is in Luke chapter 10, verse 19. Jesus said, "Behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions." Whenever you hear someone speaking about treading on something, he's speaking about having dominion and authority over it. The Bible says, "Behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions." He's not speaking about snakes and scorpions here. He's speaking about demons, my fellow believer. He's speaking about devils. He's speaking about the devil. Here's what Jesus went on to say, "And over all the power of the enemy. And nothing shall by any means hurt you." Jesus said, "Hey, you know," he said, "behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions. Not only so, but I now give unto you power over all the power of the devil." The church needs to understand that right here and right now, we already have power over all the power of the enemy. Then Jesus said, "And nothing shall by any means hurt you." You will remember that in Genesis 3:15, God was speaking to the devil who had commandeered the body of the serpent. He advised him that one day this woman's seed was going to bruise his head. Now Jesus is saying that he has released power for us to tread on serpents. This was fulfillment of this prophecy from God, my fellow believer. What does this declaration from Christ Jesus mean? Man, Jesus said that he gave us power to tread on serpents and scorpions, and he gave us power over all the power of the enemy. Jesus was here foreshadowing restoration of man's dominion mandate or man's dominion assignment. And so we praise God that Jesus was restoring. He said he came to seek and to save. He came to restore and to recover that which was lost. And so Jesus restored, he recovered our ability to manifest and to demonstrate this dominion over the earth realm, over the kingdom of darkness, my fellow believer. Then Jesus continued with his conversation with the 70. Here it is in Luke chapter 10, verse 20, the very next verse. He said, "Notwithstanding in this, rejoice not that the spirits are subject unto you, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven." My fellow believer, when you were born again, your sonship and citizenship in God's kingdom were immediately restored and duly recorded and registered in heaven. He's not just talking about you being prepared to go to heaven when you die. When you were born again, your sonship, your relationship with the Father, your place as part of God's household, your citizenship in the kingdom of heaven, these things were immediately restored and duly recorded and registered in heaven. And so Jesus restored the two primary things that man lost. Man lost his ability to fulfill his dominion assignment, and man lost his relationship and his sonship. He lost his citizenship in the kingdom of heaven. And so Christ Jesus was restoring. He said he came to seek and to save. He came to restore and to recover everything that was lost. Here's what John says about your sonship upon your rebirth, my fellow believer. This is St. John chapter 1, verse 12. The Bible says, "But as many as received him, to them gave he power." That's authority, right, and privilege to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. And so we need to understand that our sonship was restored, our citizenship was restored when we became born again. Christ Jesus told Nicodemus that rebirth was necessary to see and enter the kingdom of God. Jesus told Nicodemus in St. John chapter 3, verse 3, that except he was born again, he could not see the kingdom of God. Then he told him here in verse 5, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter or come into the kingdom of God." Traditionally in the church, we have interpreted this scripture to mean that we must be born again to go to heaven when we die. But Jesus was letting Nicodemus know that he had to be born of the water and of the Spirit if he wanted to enter or come into the kingdom of God. This scripture is speaking about our immediate entry into the kingdom of heaven, my fellow believer. When you were born again, you immediately entered the kingdom of heaven, or you became a fully naturalized citizen of God's heavenly kingdom with all the rights, privileges, benefits, authority, and power that relate to this prestigious position. Again, we need to understand when Jesus told Nicodemus that except he was born of the water and the Spirit, he could not enter. This word enter is the Greek word eisekomahi. It means to come into. And so Jesus was telling Nicodemus, listen, if you are coming to this kingdom, you need to be born of the water and of the Spirit. But as the saints of God, we need to understand that when we were born again, you immediately entered the kingdom of heaven, or you became a fully naturalized citizen of God's heavenly kingdom with all the rights, privileges, benefits, authority, and power that relate to this prestigious position. The saints of God need to realize that citizenship implies a legal contract with the government. We need to realize that governments are responsible for their citizens no matter where they are, whether they are in the home country or not. Again, we say citizenship implies a legal contract with the government. And so this is also a missing link in the body of Christ. We do not have an appreciation for our citizenship. Why? Because we're not hearing a lot about the kingdom of God. My fellow believer, religions don't have citizens. Kingdoms and countries have citizens. And so when we begin to hear about the kingdom of God, we will understand that not only are we sons of God, we will understand that we are now citizens of his heavenly kingdom, and citizenship implies a legal contract with the government. Again, we need to understand that governments are responsible for their citizens no matter where they are, whether they are in the home country or not. For example, if you are in a foreign country and you run into problems, like if you lose your passport, all you have to do is to find an embassy or a consulate of your home country and you will receive help. Why? Because worldly governments have put systems in place to take care of their citizens, even when they are outside of the home country. I believe you know we're going somewhere. Likewise, and even more so, as a kingdom citizen, the government of the kingdom of heaven is therefore fully responsible for you, even though you are not yet physically in heaven. And so if earthly governments could put systems in place to take care of their people, their citizens, while they are outside of the home country. Somebody needs to know that God has put systems in place so that we are taken care of, even though we are not yet in the home country. This is why Christ Jesus said that he gave us the keys of the kingdom. We now have access to resources from God's heavenly kingdom, even though we are not yet physically in the homeland, my fellow believer. We need to understand that this is about citizenship, and citizenship implies this contract with the government. And so you need to understand that the government of the kingdom of heaven is fully responsible for you. And even though you are not yet in heaven, the government of the kingdom of heaven has made provision for you to access resources and benefits and rights and privileges and the power and authority from your home country, even though you are still here, my fellow believer. We need to understand the power of our citizenship. Here's what Paul the Apostle said to the church at Ephesus. This is Ephesians chapter 2, verse 19. The saints of God need to be reminded of the fact that they are now citizens of God's heavenly kingdom. Ephesians 2, 19 says, "Now therefore ye are." The first two highlights that we have here. Jesus is not speaking about the sweet by and by when you die. The Bible says, "Now therefore ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God." And so, my fellow believer, you are now. This is not in the sweet by and by when you die. Now therefore you are fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God. Praise the name of Jesus. Here's what Paul the Apostle said to the church at Philippi. Paul is letting us know that our citizenship is now in heaven. This is Philippians chapter 3, verse 20. Paul said a thing here. He said, "For our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ." If you're looking in your King James Version, it says, "For our conversation is in heaven." The word conversation is the Greek word polituma. That's P-O-L-I-T-E-U-M-A. Paul is letting us know that our citizenship is now in heaven. Praise the name of Jesus. And so we're eagerly looking for our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. But because our citizenship is now in heaven, through and by virtue of our access and our possession of the keys of the kingdom, we now have access to rights and privileges and benefits. Through our faith, we can reach into God's invisible kingdom and access resources that we need to experience victory, my fellow believer, even though we are not yet in the home country. Now, in his book called Preparing for Kingdom Experience and Expansion, Dr. Miles Monroe helps us to understand our obligations as citizens of the kingdom of heaven. Here's what Dr. Miles Monroe said. "As citizens of heaven, we inhabit the earth for the purpose of influencing it with the culture and values of heaven and bringing it under the government of the King of Heaven." Again, as citizens of heaven, we inhabit the earth for the purpose of influencing it with the culture and values of heaven and bringing it under the government of the King of Heaven. And so here's what happened in the spirit realm when you accepted God's plan of salvation and were born again. Remember, by virtue of the rebellion and disobedience and high treason and declaration of independence
of Adam and Eve,
the flag of the kingdom of Satan or the kingdom of darkness is flying over the earth. We praise the name of Jesus that Christ Jesus came to remedy this situation. But here's what happened to you as an individual when you were born again. What you did was you lowered the flag of the kingdom of Satan or the kingdom of darkness. Then, my fellow believer, you declared that Jesus Christ is Lord, and you raised the flag of the kingdom of God or the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of light. This is after your acceptance of God's plan of salvation, because we gave our hearts to God and became his children and citizens of his heavenly kingdom. His original governmental structure and divine order have been restored in our lives. Now, as the saints of God, the legitimate government of our lives was restored. As believers, we are now flying the flag of the kingdom of heaven over our lives. Why? Because we are now under another government. We are part of another kingdom. Praise the name of Jesus. You will recall that the key to return of God's kingdom government to the earth was the return of the royal governor or God's Holy Spirit. Remember, when we in the Bahamas declared independence, we had a royal governor. He was the most important person in our country at the time. His name was Sir John Warburton Paul. After the Bahamas declared independence, Sir John Warburton Paul, who represented the interests of the Queen of England in our country, he had to leave our country, and he did not return in his official capacity anymore. And so because we declared independence from Great Britain, the royal governor had to leave the Bahamas. He lived in Government House on Duke Street. He represented the will and the purpose of the Queen of England. Holy Spirit was the local resident representative of the King of Heaven. Holy Spirit symbolized the royal governor from heaven. After Adam and Eve sinned against God, the royal governor had to leave. Why? Because God told Adam and Eve that in the day that they ate from that tree, they would experience death. And Holy Spirit was the source of their life. And so the only way they could die is if they lost Holy Spirit. And so my fellow believer, if you look through the entire Old Testament, you will see that the Spirit of God came upon the prophet or the priest or the king or whomever God chose so that God could minister and execute his will in the earth. But no one was filled with Holy Spirit until after Christ Jesus came. Why? Because the royal governor needed to get back in the colony. And so Jesus Christ was restoring God's kingdom government in the earth, my fellow believer. Praise the name of Jesus. And so we need to remember that the presence of the governor is indicative of the presence of the kingdom. And so again, even in the Bahamas, when Queen Elizabeth had kingdom, or when she had authority or dominion of the Bahamas, the royal governor was here representing her interest. But when she lost that power, when she lost that kingdom, when she lost that governing influence and sovereign rulership, the royal governor had to leave. And so my fellow believer, the presence of the governor is indicative of the presence of the kingdom. This is why Christ Jesus, he wanted to get Holy Spirit back into the colony. The symbol of a king or queen's authority, royal power, jurisdiction or dominion in a colony is the presence of the royal governor. And so as long as that governor is there, the government is there, my fellow believer. And so because Jesus came with government upon his shoulder, Jesus' primary mission was to do whatever it took to get the royal governor or God's Holy Spirit back into the colony. And more importantly, his mission was to get the royal governor back into government house, which was our bodies. And so this is why Jesus died on the cross. We need to understand that the return of the governor meant return of the government. Jesus came with government upon his shoulder. And so you need to know that Jesus did not just wash you in his blood so that you could be prepared to go to heaven when you die. He washed you so that your body could qualify as a suitable residence for his Holy Spirit one more time, so that the royal governor could come back, so the government of the kingdom of heaven could be restored and returned to this earth, so that the earth could again be brought back under God's kingdom government, so that we could again qualify to manifest the culture, power, and authority of the kingdom of God. Jesus Christ was returning the kingdom to the earth. And so, my fellow believer, this is why Jesus washed you in his blood, so that your body could qualify as a suitable residence or mansion or temple for his Holy Spirit, because the return of the governor, the return of the Holy Spirit meant return of the government. And guess what? Because the cleansing power of the blood of Jesus was released at Calvary, those who accepted God's plan of salvation again qualified as suitable residents for the royal governor from heaven. And so, my fellow believer, the royal governor returned in his fullness on the day of Pentecost. The return of the governor meant return of the government. And Isaiah said that Jesus came with government upon his shoulder. And so Jesus' mission, his dying on the cross, his death on the cross was not just about you going to heaven when you die. His death on the cross was preparing your body so that the royal governor could again come upon you and come within you, so that you could be endued with power from on high, so that you could manifest the culture, power, and authority of the kingdom. Remember that the first manifestation of the return of the royal governor was that the Bible says they began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Somebody needs to know that tongues is not a religious experience. Tongues are a kingdom experience. What are you saying, Pastor McFaul? Well, my fellow believer, remember that in the beginning it was Queen Isabella and King Ferdinand that sent Christopher Columbus to the Bahamas, and they were from the imperial power of Spain. The Bahamas was claimed for the kingdom of Spain, but eventually the kingdom of Great Britain defeated Spain and they took possession of the Bahamas. And so you need to know that if Great Britain did not defeat the Spanish and take possession of the Bahamas, we would all be speaking Spanish today. Because Spanish is the language of the imperial power who initially took possession or claimed the colony of the Bahamas. And so in the Bahamas, we speak the Queen's English. Why? Because we used to be a colony of Great Britain. If you look in the island of Cuba, Cuba was colonized by Spain. And so they speak Spanish over there. And so language is indicative of the imperial power that colonized the country. The greatest example of this is on Hispaniola, where the left side, which is Haiti, it speaks French, and the right side, which is the Dominican Republic, they speak Spanish. Why? Because the left side was colonized by France, and the right side was colonized by Spain. And so the language was indicative of the home country or the imperial power that colonized those countries. And so, my fellow believer, this is why the disciples spoke in tongues. Why? Because the imperial power colony relationship between heaven and earth was being restored. And so tongues are not a religious this experience. It's a kingdom experience. And so the fact that they were able to speak in heavenly languages, this confirmed their reconnection to the kingdom of heaven. And so we need to understand that all of this was happening. Jesus Christ was returning the government to the earth, my fellow believer. The earth was again being brought back under his Father's kingdom government. And so because of the governor's return, we now have the ability to reflect kingdom culture and to demonstrate kingdom power and authority. Holy Spirit represents the presence of the King of Heaven and therefore the government of heaven. And Holy Spirit is not just there to make us feel good and all tingly. You know, growing up in church, this is what I always thought. I always thought that Holy Spirit, he came so that I could run up and down and shout and run, my fellow believer. Whilst we might experience the presence of Holy Spirit, we need to understand that this is a kingdom experience. The presence of Holy Spirit in your life confirms your reconnection to the kingdom of heaven. Holy Spirit now empowers you to reflect the culture, power, and authority of the kingdom of heaven, my fellow believer. Holy Spirit confirms your citizenship and your sonship. Praise the name of Jesus. And so when you were born again, you did not receive religion. You received the kingdom. Again, when you were born again, you did not receive religion. You received the kingdom. Paul confirms this for us in his letter to the Hebrews. This is Hebrews chapter 12, verse 28. Paul says, "Wherefore we, receiving a kingdom which cannot be moved, let us have grace whereby we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear." And so, my fellow believer, when you were born again, you received a kingdom. And so we'll see exactly what this means. This was God's plan all along. God's plan was the reestablishment of his kingdom on the earth and the return of the kingdom and position of dominion to mankind. This was the primary focus and purpose for the ministry of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. This was not just about you getting ready to go to heaven when you die. The first thing that Jesus asks us to pray for is thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Jesus' focus was the return of God's kingdom to the earth, my fellow believer, so that more of his will would be done in the earth as it has always been done in heaven. This is why Jesus said the following to his disciples. We saw this a little earlier, but we'll focus on it and we'll clarify it a little bit. This is Luke chapter 22, verse 29. Jesus said, "And I appoint unto you a kingdom, as my Father hath appointed unto me. I appoint unto you a kingdom, as my Father hath appointed unto me." This is the King James version of this scripture. It might not be so clear. So let's take a look at the Message Bible version of this same scripture. Look at what Jesus said to you, my fellow believer. He said, "Now I confer on you the royal authority my Father conferred on me, my Lord Almighty." Again, I say I am convinced that this is the missing link in the body of Christ. We do not understand that Jesus has appointed unto us the kingdom. He has transferred the right power and authority to reign and exercise dominion on the earth as the body of Christ, as believers. Jesus says to you tonight, "Now I confer on you the royal authority that my Father conferred on me." Christ Jesus has conferred on us the same royal authority, my fellow believer, and power that he demonstrated whilst he was on the earth. This is what he meant when he said the following to us in St. John chapter 14, verse 12. Jesus said, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, I say this unto you now, remember, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. And I say unto you, that he that believeth on me, the works that I do, shall he do also. And the greater works than these shall he do." Why? "Because I go unto my Father." And so because he conferred on us the same royal authority that he had, we are now empowered to do the same works that he did, and even greater works. You know, Daniel 4 saw this day when the saints of God would again possess the kingdom as a result of the completed mission of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Again, we say when Jesus declared on the cross, "It is finished." In the body of Christ, we have a tendency to focus on the fact that he washed us in his blood and we're now ready to go to heaven when we die. But "it is finished" meant restoration of God's kingdom on the earth. "It is finished" meant restoration and return of the right power and authority to exercise dominion to the saints of God. And so again, we say Daniel 4 saw this day when, as a result of the finished work of Calvary, the saints of God would again possess the kingdom. Here it is in Daniel chapter 7, verse 18. Look at what Daniel says about you, my fellow believer. Daniel said, "But the saints of the Most High shall take the kingdom and possess the kingdom forever, even forever and ever." And so Jesus appointed unto us the kingdom. And so this is why we need to understand that we have the same power and authority that Jesus had. Jesus was modeling for us, my fellow believer. Jesus is our example. He is our prototype. And so the things that Jesus Christ was doing, this was not just meant for us to use as we preach and as we teach the word of God. Jesus was demonstrating for us what would happen in our lives, what is now possible in our lives, what is our potential because of the presence of the royal governor, God's Holy Spirit on the inside of us, what is now possible because the kingdom of God has come unto us, my fellow believer. What is now possible? We are now able to manifest the culture, power, and authority of the kingdom. Daniel said, but the saints of the Most High shall take the kingdom and possess the kingdom. I believe that it's time for the church, the body of Christ, to take possession of the kingdom and walk in kingdom power and authority right now. I believe that if we do this, the world will not see us as being non-essential, unnecessary, useless. This is what the world said about us, my fellow believer. The church is non-essential. Shut them down. The word non-essential, again, we say is unnecessary, useless, without any effect or any significance. Non-essential means that if I invite you to a party, if you come, it makes no difference. If you don't come, it makes no difference. And so this is what the world said about us. The only thing that I can think about is where Jesus said that if the salt has lost its savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is thenceforth good for nothing but to be cast out and to be trodden under foot of men. This is what Jesus said about us. But he said, we are the salt of the earth, and the world sees us as being non-essential. Why? Because we have not yet taken possession of the kingdom and began to manifest the culture, power, and authority of the kingdom. Here's Daniel again in Daniel chapter 7, verse 27. Daniel said, and the kingdom and the dominion and the greatness of the kingdom under the whole heaven shall be given to the people of the saints of the Most High, whose kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and all dominion shall serve and obey him. Daniel 4 saw this day. And so we can read this scripture in the past. The kingdom and the dominion and the greatness of the kingdom under the whole heaven has been given to the people of the saints of the Most High. And so we need to understand this. And so because the kingdom was restored to the saints of God, Paul the Apostle confirmed our appointment as ambassadors. Paul says a thing to us here in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 20. Paul says, now then, again, this is not in the sweet by and by when you die. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us. We pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God. And so we are now ambassadors for Christ. As ambassadors for Christ, our mission is to influence this territory for our God and his kingdom and help to bring it back under God's government. Our mission is to continue with Jesus' work of declaring, reclaiming, advancing, promoting, and expanding his Father's kingdom here on this earth. Our mission, my fellow believer, is to continue to do the work that Jesus began whilst he was here on the earth. Because our sonship, citizenship, and dominion mandate were restored, the prophet Micah lets us know that we can now expect to walk in and demonstrate the first dominion that was exercised by Adam and Eve before they fell. Again, because our sonship, citizenship, and dominion mandate were restored, the prophet Micah, he lets us know that we can now expect to walk in and demonstrate the first dominion exercised by Adam and Eve before they fell. Here's what Micah says to us. This is Micah chapter 4, verse 8. Micah said, and thou, O tower of the flock, the stronghold of the daughter of Zion. Look at what Micah says to you. Unto thee shall it come, even the first dominion. He said, the kingdom shall come to the daughter of Jerusalem. Again, Micah says unto us, he said, unto us shall come the first dominion. This is the dominion, my fellow believer, that was exercised and manifested in the lives of Adam and Eve. The Lord wants his people to walk in this first dominion. He wants you to know that because Christ Jesus defeated the devil and shed his blood, your body was cleansed and again qualified to house his Holy Spirit, the royal governor from heaven, who represents the presence and power of the King and Kingdom of Heaven, now lives on the inside of us. We can manifest the first dominion. We need to understand this. This is why in the body of Christ, we need to hear this wonderful gospel of the kingdom, my fellow believer. And so as Jesus divided the spoils, and he appointed unto us a kingdom as his Father had appointed unto him, Jesus effectively transferred the custody of the kingdom to mankind, but he transferred it specifically to believers. And so again, we say that in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. God had dominion and authority over both heaven and earth. Then God made a decision. He said, let us make man, let them have dominion. By so doing, God transferred the custody of the government or kingdom of the earth to mankind, because and by virtue and through their disobedience, rebellion, high treason, and declaration of independence, Adam and Eve transferred the custody of the kingdom to the devil. He bragged about this as he tempted Christ Jesus, and Jesus Christ came down. He defeated that devil, as we saw. Then he attended that ceremony in heaven that Daniel saw, and then he came back and he declared, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. And then Jesus Christ appointed unto us the kingdom. And so, my fellow believer, what Jesus did, because he was returning to heaven, he transferred the custody of the kingdom to us and to believers. And so we need to understand this in the body of Christ. Again, unfortunately, many believers are not aware that the custody of the kingdom was transferred to and now rests with the church. I believe that this is the missing link in the body of Christ. I believe that we are not experiencing a greater manifestation of power and authority in the church. Why? Because we do not understand that Jesus has conferred on us the same royal authority that he had, and by virtue of our possession of the kingdom, we are now able to do the same works that Jesus did, and even greater works. My fellow believer, as sons of God, citizens of his heavenly kingdom, and the possessors of the kingdom, we are now empowered to walk in the first dominion and demonstrate the power and authority exercised by Christ Jesus whilst he was on the earth. Jesus defeated the enemy. He redeemed mankind and received and transferred the custody of the kingdom to believers. And so we said that the Bible is all about a kingdom established, a kingdom surrendered, a kingdom recovered or restored, and a kingdom to come. We looked at a kingdom established in the Garden of Eden. We looked at a kingdom surrendered in the Garden of Eden. And as a result of Jesus' death on the cross, his receipt of kingdom authority from God, remember Daniel's vision, and the eventual transfer of the custody of the kingdom to mankind or the saints of God by Christ Jesus, this was the kingdom recovered or kingdom restored. Again, as a result of Jesus' death on the cross, his receipt of kingdom authority from God, and the eventual transfer of the custody of the kingdom to the saints of God or mankind by Christ Jesus, this was a kingdom recovered or a kingdom restored. And so here ends this aspect of what the Bible is all about, a kingdom recovered or a kingdom restored. Now, when Jesus returns to the earth, there will be one final transfer of the custody of the kingdom. This will be a kingdom to come. A kingdom to come. There's one more transfer of the custody of the kingdom that will take place, and this will take place when Christ Jesus returns. Remember what Paul said to us through his letter to the Corinthians. This is 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 24. Paul said a thing here. He said, then cometh the end, when he, that's Christ Jesus, shall have delivered up the kingdom to God, even the Father, when he shall have put down all rule and all authority and all power. Again, Paul says, when the end comes, when Christ Jesus returns, he shall deliver up the kingdom to God, and he's going to put down all rule and all authority and all power. And so, my fellow believer, when the devil's rule is fully obliterated and eliminated from the earth, Jesus Christ will deliver the kingdom back up to God. The kingdom will be delivered up to God when the devil's rule and the influence and culture of the kingdom of darkness are fully eradicated from the earth. This is when the devil and the beast and the false prophet will be cast into the lake of fire and be tormented day and night forever. That's Revelation chapter 20, verse 10. Here's part of John's prophetic revelation of the age to come. This is Revelation chapter 12, verse 10. We're speaking about a kingdom to come. Here's what John said. John says, and I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now is come salvation and strength and what? And the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. Complete salvation and the full restoration of the kingdom of God and the power of his Christ will only come when the accuser of our brethren is cast down and completely destroyed. Of course, we're speaking about that devil. But John began to declare, now is come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. When the accuser of the brethren is cast down, then will come full salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. Remember what happened during Jesus' temptation. Again, this is Luke chapter 4, verses 5 to 6. The Bible says, and the devil, taking him up into an high mountain, shewed unto him what? All the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. The devil showed Jesus the kingdoms of the world. We want to focus on that. The devil showed Jesus the kingdoms of the world, and then he went on to say that all this power will I give thee and the glory of them. Why? For that is delivered unto me. And so the devil was letting Christ Jesus know that he was the possessor of the kingdoms of this world. During the temptation of Christ Jesus, the devil boasted and he bragged about possessing the kingdoms of this world. But here's what the great voices in heaven will declare when the enemy is fully bound and defeated at the end of the age. This is Revelation chapter 11, verse 15. The Bible says, and the seventh angel sounded, and there were great voices in heaven saying, the kingdoms of this world are become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. We saw the devil bragging about possession of the kingdoms of this world. But John lets us know that after that seventh angel sounds, there will be great voices in heaven saying, the kingdoms of this world are become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. My fellow believer, again, we say this is our God's highest priority. Christ Jesus came to defeat that devil to begin the process of restoring the earth as part of God's kingdom under God's government. This is why he came. This is why he washed you in his blood. This is why he empowered the body of Christ to finish his work. John says after that seventh angel sounds, there will be great voices in heaven saying the kingdoms of this world are become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he alone shall reign forever and ever. This will be the ultimate restoration of the kingdom of God on the earth and fulfillment of our God's highest priority. This will bring the custody of the kingdom full circle and back to God and to Christ, to whom he delivered all things. Again, this will bring the custody of the kingdom full circle and back to God and also to Christ Jesus, because God delivered all things to Christ Jesus. Notice John says here, the kingdoms of this world are become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ. The kingdom will be delivered both to God and to Christ. Why? Because God turned everything over to his son, Christ Jesus. He delivered all things unto Christ Jesus. And so we saw this, where the kingdom began with God, was transferred to mankind, then transferred to Satan. Jesus came down, defeated that devil. Jesus Christ, he washed us in his blood. He transferred the kingdom to mankind, or the saints of God. Then at the end of the age, the kingdom will be delivered back up to God and Christ. My fellow believer, this is a snapshot of your entire Bible in a single illustration. We have a tendency to focus on the stories in the Bible, but this is the story that runs through the heart of the Bible. The Bible is all about restoration of God's kingdom on the earth. We have a tendency to look at stories about David and Goliath. My fellow believer, Goliath could not kill David. Why? Because David had the Messiah in his belly. God had already told that devil in Genesis 3:15 that the seed of this woman was coming down through the ages to bruise your head. And so Goliath could not kill David. Whatever we see happening, even in the days of Esther, where Haman wanted to wipe out the Jews, this could not happen. Why? Because Jesus Christ would have been aborted. Because Jesus Christ, the seed, was coming down through the ages. And so the Old Testament is all about the preservation and the prophecy, all about our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Remember, Jesus said that, lo, I come in the volume of the book, it is written of me. Jesus said that he came to fulfill the law and the prophets. The Old Testament is all about Christ Jesus. Everything that God was doing in the Old Testament, he was preserving the seed that was coming down through the ages. This is why the New Testament begins with the genealogy of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We need to understand that this is the dispensation of the kingdom. Again, we say this particular illustration is the snapshot of your entire Bible. Again, this illustration is a snapshot of your entire Bible. And so this is a brief review of a kingdom to come, which we just completed. And so here ends our teaching on the kingdom of God, which we hope helps you to understand this key, central, and largely ignored part of God and Jesus' agenda and mission for the church. Again, here ends our teaching on the kingdom of God, which unfortunately we don't focus on in the church a whole lot, even though this was the primary focus of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. You know, I'm in the process of reading a book called Studies in the Kingdom of God by Brother Tom Casey. I believe this is the third time that I'm reading this book. And so Brother Casey lets us know why it is important for us to understand the kingdom of God. And so this is what we're seeking to do through this kingdom summit. We're seeking to help the people of God to understand the kingdom of God. And so as we prepare to close tonight, I wish to share an extract from Brother Tom Casey's book called Studies in the Kingdom of God. Brother Casey said, we cannot fully grasp and accomplish our purpose on the earth as human beings and as followers of Jesus without a clear understanding and first-hand experience of the reality of the presence of the kingdom of God and its activities in our lives. Again, Brother Casey said, we cannot fully grasp and accomplish our purpose on the earth as human beings and as followers of Jesus without a clear understanding and first-hand experience of the reality of the presence of the kingdom of God and its activities in our lives. If we as the body of Christ are expected to complete the work that Jesus started while he was on the earth, our mission must first begin with an understanding of his mission, which was recovering and reestablishing God's kingdom on the earth. And so as we close the night, in a nutshell, what is the kingdom of God? What is the kingdom of God? Well, firstly, here's a definition of the word kingdom as extracted from Strong's Concordance with Greek and Hebrew dictionary. The Bible says that out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. And Christ Jesus spoke about the kingdom more than anything else. But I wonder how many of us took a moment to seek to discover a definition for the word kingdom. Well, the word kingdom is the Greek word basileia. That's B-A-S-I-L-E-I-A. You see, we have a preconceived notion of kingdom. We think kingdom is this country. But here is a definition for this word kingdom. The word kingdom being Greek word basileia. It means royal power. It means royalty. It means kingship. It means reign, dominion. It means the right and authority to rule over a domain or territory. Remember now, Jesus gave us instructions in Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. He said, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and the things that we need will simply be added to us. And so we need to understand what this kingdom is. Kingdom is royal power. Kingdom is royalty. Kingdom is kingship, reign, dominion, the right and authority to rule over a domain or a territory. Here's another extract from Brother Tom Casey's book called Studies in the Kingdom of God, which defines kingdom. Brother Casey says, kingdom is the sovereignty and authority one possesses, which enables him or her to rule. My fellow believer, Christ Jesus said that the kingdom of heaven is like unto treasure. He said that the kingdom of heaven is like unto a merchant man seeking goodly pearls. Jesus said the kingdom of heaven is like unto leaven. Jesus said the kingdom of heaven is like unto a mustard seed. Jesus highlighted and he underscored the value of the kingdom in his parables. And so we need to understand what the kingdom is. And so Brother Tom Casey says here in this extract from his book called Studies in the Kingdom of God, that kingdom is the sovereignty and authority one possesses, which enables him or her to rule. As it relates to the kingdom of God, firstly, the kingdom of God is the reign or government or sovereign rulership or governing authority and influence or royal power and dominion of God, the King of heaven. Remember, Jesus came with government upon his shoulder. Unfortunately, in the church, we kind of disregard those scriptures. This was Jesus's burden. This was his assignment. This was his work. This is what he came to do. He came to return God's kingdom government to the earth. And so we need to understand that Jesus came preaching and declaring the arrival of God's kingdom on the earth. He was speaking about the return of the reign of God. He's speaking about the return of the sovereign rulership and governing influence and authority and royal power and dominion of God, the King of heaven. And secondly, the kingdom of God is the realm into which the saints of God immediately enter and the environment or atmosphere that is created by the gospel, whereby mankind is positioned to experience the culture, blessings, power, and authority of God's reign, that is life under God's government, both now and throughout eternity. And so these are the two dimensions of the kingdom. The kingdom is firstly about the reign of God or the rule of God, but it's also about the realm into which the saints of God immediately enter. It's also the environment that's created as we preach the gospel of the kingdom. Remember, this is what Jesus did. The Bible teaches that Jesus went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing all manner of sickness and all manner of disease among the people. Jesus was letting the people know that the kingdom or a reign or a rule or government of God had arrived on the earth. And then because he was preaching the kingdom, he created this atmosphere and this environment so that the kingdom could be manifested through mighty signs and wonders. And so Jesus was preaching about the kingdom. Then he was confirming and proving and verifying and validating that the kingdom had arrived. And he was also demonstrating the operation of the kingdom in his life. And so again, I ask the question, could it be? This is why we're not experiencing a greater manifestation of power and authority in the church, because we're not preaching this gospel of the kingdom. God wants to confirm the word with signs following. He wants to confirm that his kingdom is here. And so we need to understand this. And so because the kingdom features so prominently in the life and the ministry of Christ Jesus and should be the priority, focus, and primary mission of the church, we all need a better understanding of the kingdom of God. We praise the name of Jesus. We need a better understanding of the kingdom of God. This is why for the past almost 7 years, I've committed my life to seeking to understand this kingdom, my fellow believer. This is why I work so diligently to try to understand the kingdom of God. And so we bless the name of Jesus. We give him thanks. We give him praise. We give him glory and honor. Bless the name of Jesus. We praise him and we thank him. Praise God. And so we thank God for this wonderful night. We praise him for all that he continues to do. We bless the name of Jesus for his goodness and his grace and his loving kindness, which is better than life. Bless the name of Jesus. And so here ends our kingdom summit, where we sought to systematically and comprehensively go through the Bible and other literature and information that we've been exposed to help the people of God to understand the kingdom of God. And so praise God. Let's just bow in a word of prayer. We believe that this is the dispensation where God is revealing the mysteries of his kingdom to the people of God. Praise God. Let's just bow in a word of prayer as we conclude this night. Bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Bless the name of Jesus. Heavenly Father, we come before in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Father God, we give you thanks and praise, glory and honor, might and dominion and power. Lord, we thank you, Lord God, for this word this night. We thank you for the word that we've covered during the course of this kingdom summit. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, my Father God, we just bless you. We give you glory and honor, might and dominion and power. We thank you, Lord God, for what our hearts have received, Lord God, in the name of Jesus Christ. We begin to prophesy over the people of God and declare that they shall never be the same again, my Father. We thank you, Lord God, that we shall never see our Bibles the same way again. We thank you, Lord God, that we shall have, Lord God, a greater understanding and revelation of why Christ Jesus came. Father God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we understand and know that indeed Christ Jesus came to position us to go to heaven when we die. But we need to understand that this was not the primary focus of the ministry of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We thank you for sending Christ Jesus to restore your kingdom government on the earth. And we thank you, Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, as your word declares that it is your good pleasure to give us the kingdom, my Father. And so, Lord God, we begin to pray, Lord God, as the people of God, for hearts to seek first, Lord God, as a priority, your kingdom and your righteousness, O God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. We just begin to glorify you. We extol you, Lord God. We magnify you, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. We declare the kingdom of God has come unto the people of God in the name of Jesus Christ. We believe, O God, that in this dispensation, O God, you're breathing life, Father God, afresh, Lord God, into the body of Christ. We believe, O God, in the name of Jesus Christ, my Father. We begin to pray, Father God, like Paul the Apostle prayed, my Father God, for the saints of God, for the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of you, my Father God, in the name of Jesus. The eyes of our understanding being enlightened, O God, that we would know what is the hope of your calling, my Father, and what is the exceeding greatness of your power to us who believe, Lord God, in the name of Jesus Christ. When you, Lord God, raised Jesus from the dead and set him at your own right hand, Father God, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, O God, in Jesus' name, and gave him to be the head of all things to the church, the fullness of his body, which filleth all in all. And so, my Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, we began to pray and declare the kingdom of God has come unto the people of God. Father God, we began to pray for, Father God, spiritual leaders, O God. We lift up apostles and prophets and evangelists and pastor teachers, O God, in Jesus' name. We pray, O God, that as spiritual leaders, O God, we would more diligently seek your kingdom, my Father. Seek to understand, Lord God, about this kingdom, oh God. Seek, Lord God, to understand what it means to live in this kingdom, my Father. Seek, Lord God, to understand what it means to remain in right alignment with this kingdom, oh God, in Jesus' name. Father God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth, my Father. And then teach, Lord God, this gospel of the kingdom to the people of God, my Father, that they, Lord God, would more fully enter the kingdom of God. We thank you, Lord God, that Christ Jesus, Lord God, blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. Christ Jesus raised us up and caused us to sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. We thank you, Lord God, that Father God, Christ Jesus gave us the keys of the kingdom. And Father God, by virtue of our possession of these keys, we have access to resources, Father God, rights and benefits and privileges, O God, from your heavenly kingdom right now, my Father. We thank you, Lord God, that through our rebirth, my Father, Lord God, our sonship has been restored, our citizenship been restored. We have been appointed as your ambassadors, O God, in Jesus' name. We now carry, Father God, the power and the authority of your kingdom, O God, in Jesus' name. Not even as Paul told, Lord God, the church, Father God, at Rome. We are now, Father God, empowered to reign in life, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. Because, oh God, we are now possessors of the kingdom, my Father. We know, Lord God, that the kingdom will only be, Father God, fully delivered unto you, Father God, and Christ Jesus, when Christ Jesus returns, oh God. But we in the body of Christ, my Father God, we now possess the kingdom, oh God. And so, Lord God, as the saints of God, my Father God, we thank you, Lord God, that we receive a better, Father God, and greater revelation of the fact that we now possess the kingdom, oh God, in Jesus' name. And so, Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, we, Father God, begin to declare, even as Christ Jesus told those Pharisees in St. Luke chapter 17, around verses 20 and 21, as Jesus said, the kingdom of God cometh not with observation, neither shall they say, lo here or lo there, for the kingdom of God is within us. And so we thank you, Lord God, that through the presence of royal governor, Father God, on the inside of us, through the presence of your Holy Spirit, your kingdom now dwells within us, O God, in Jesus' name. And not only so, my Father God, as we preach and declare this gospel of the kingdom, your kingdom will be manifested among us and in our midst. And so for this reason, my Father God, we believe that we shall, Lord God, be able, O God, to experience, Lord God, the culture, power, and authority of your kingdom right here and right now, oh God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And so, my Father God, we begin to worship you, we glorify you, Father God, we extol you, my Father, Lord God, in the name of Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord God, for light and enlightenment, oh God, for you're the one, Father God, who delivered us from the power of darkness, my Father, and you translated or you transferred or you repatriated us into the kingdom of your dear Son, oh God. And so, Lord God, we just praise you, we glorify you, we worship you, we magnify you, for you are God alone, oh God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. But my Father God, even now in this dispensation, we need to diligently pursue your kingdom, O God, as if our life depends on it, Lord. For indeed it does, my Father. For Christ Jesus declared that the kingdom of heaven is like unto treasure hid in a field, the which when a man had found, for joy thereof he hideth, and he sold all that he had, and he purchased that field. Jesus said the kingdom of heaven is like unto a merchant man seeking goodly pearls, who when he had found one pearl of great price, he too went and sold all that he had, and he purchased that pearl. Jesus said the kingdom of heaven is like unto leaven, which a woman took and hid in three measures of meal. And so, my Father God, I thank you that, Lord God, the leaven of this kingdom, the leaven of this word, Lord God, quietly, Lord God, working its way through the hearts of the people of God, my Father. Lord God, we thank you that you're generating a hunger and a thirst, my Father, after righteousness, Lord God, in the lives of the people of God. For Christ Jesus declared that they that do hunger and thirst after righteousness, they shall be filled, O God. We thank you, my Father God, that we come, my Father God, as your disciples, O God, understanding that a disciple is one, Father God, who was, Lord God, determined and decided to establish a relationship with somebody so that they could be with them, so that they could learn from them, so that they could be just like them. And so, my Father God, we thank you that in this dispensation, Lord God, you're looking for disciples, Lord God. You said that we should come unto you, my Father, all us who labor and are heavy laden. You promised to give us rest, my Father. You, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, instructed us to take your yoke upon us and to learn of you, my Father. And so, my Father God, we thank you that in this dispensation, we're learning of you, my Father God, in the name of Jesus. We just began to pray, my Father God, that as the kingdom, my Father, was the primary focus of the life and the ministry of our Lord Jesus Christ, Father God, in the name of Jesus, in this dispensation, the kingdom, O God, but again, be the primary focus of the church. Even as Christ Jesus tells us, Lord God, in Matthew chapter 24, around verse 14, Jesus said, and this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. And so, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, my Father God, I thank you for letting us know that the end will not come until we begin to preach this gospel of the kingdom, until this gospel of the kingdom is preached in all the world. And so, Father God, we thank you, my Father God, that the end is not come as yet. Why? Because we have not preached this gospel of the kingdom in all the world as yet. And so, Father God, we thank you, my Father, that the preaching of this gospel of the kingdom must begin with an understanding, with a revelation of the kingdom, my Father. We cannot preach, Father God, what we do not understand. And so we thank you, Lord God, that in this dispensation, because, Lord God, you are the one who lay up sound wisdom for the righteous, Lord God, in you, in Christ Jesus, dwells, Father God, all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge, my Father God. We thank you, my Father God, that you, Lord God, are revealing the mysteries of the kingdom to the people of God. And so, Lord God, even now we seal this word in the hearts and the minds of the people of God. Again, we prophesy that your people shall never be the same again. We thank you, my Father God, that we, Lord God, are being, Father God, transformed, Lord, by the renewing of our minds, Lord God, in the name of Jesus Christ. Even now, my Father God, we thank you, Lord, for turning hearts toward you. Perhaps someone, Lord God, is listening, Lord God, or they may not be listening. But, Father God, every unsaved person, our loved ones, people we know, people we don't know, we thank you, Lord God, for turning their hearts, Lord God, toward you, my Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ. We pray, oh God, that they would yield themselves to you, oh God, that they would, Lord God, willingly, Father God, and voluntarily come under your governing influence, influence and sovereign rulership and to declare, Lord, that Jesus Christ is Lord. Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, we thank you for letting them know, oh God, that you're still looking for children for your family. You're still looking for citizens for your heavenly kingdom. You're still looking to appoint new ambassadors. My Father, you're still looking, Lord, for some people, Lord God, who, Lord God, are able to experience life and life more abundantly, or the quality of life under your government, oh God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, my Father. And so, Lord God, we thank you. Even now, we lift up the people of God, Father God, in the name of Jesus. Perhaps someone is listening, Father, who has some ailment, some sickness in their body. We begin to declare that the kingdom of God has come into the people of God even now. Father God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we begin to declare, Lord God, the kingdom of God has come. And because the kingdom of God has come, Lord God, we thank you for manifesting, Lord God, the culture, Father God, of your kingdom. Lord God, because there's no sickness up in heaven, Lord God, and we begin to declare that the kingdom of God has arrived on the earth, oh God, through the person of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, my Father, through the return of the royal governor, oh God's Holy Spirit. We thank you for manifesting the culture of the kingdom in the lives of your people. We drive every spirit of infirmity from the bodies of the people. Every sickness, every disease is driven from the bodies of the people of God. We begin to declare healing and wholeness, Lord God, in the bodies of the people of God, from the crowns of their head to the soles of their feet, oh God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord God, as we begin to release kingdom authority and power. We thank you, Lord God, and we stand, oh God, as your ambassadors, as your diplomats, Father God, your envoys and your plenipotentiaries, oh God, in Jesus' name. Father God, we stand as those, Father God, who are officially authorized to represent your kingdom, Father God, and declare healing and wholeness, my Father God, Lord God, in every nerve, Father God, every muscle, every bone, every fiber of the being of your people. Father God, we thank you because your word declares, Father God, that because we serve you, Lord God, you promised to bless our bread and our water, Lord God, and you promised to take sickness and disease from our midst, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you that your word declares, oh God, that because we've made you, even the Most High, our habitation, Lord God, no evil shall befall us, O God, and no plague shall come nigh our dwelling. Your word again declares, O God, that you are the one who anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good, healing all that were oppressed of the devil. And so because sickness and disease, they are oppressions of the devil, we thank you, Lord God, and Father God, even as Christ Jesus spoke to that woman who was bowed over for 18 years. We say, woman of God, we say, man of God, be thou loosed from your infirmity even now. For John declared in 1 John 3, and 8, that for this purpose was the Son of God manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. And so we thank you, Father God, in the name of Jesus, that every work of the devil is destroyed from off the bodies of the people of God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. We thank you that Christ Jesus bore, Father God, our sickness, and he took our infirmities, and by his stripes we are healed. And because he bore our sickness, because he took our infirmities, we don't have to bear them anymore, because that devil no longer has jurisdiction over us. We now have diplomatic immunity, because and by virtue of our position as the ambassadors of Christ, we thank you for protecting the people of God from all sickness and all disease, Lord. Even in this dispensation, Lord God, in the midst, Father God, of this, Lord God, pandemic, we thank you that your word again declares that because we've made you, Father God, even the Most High, our habitation, no evil shall befall us, and no plague shall come nigh our dwelling. We thank you, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, as we speak, Lord God, Father God, total healing and deliverance, Father God, into the bodies of the people of God and into the minds of the people of God. Your word declares, Lord God, that you will supply all of our need according to your riches in glory by Christ Jesus. And so we declare every need met right now, Father God, whether it be financial, Father God, whether it be emotional, whether it be spiritual, whether it be physical, whether it be sickness, whether it be disease, whatever it is, my Father God, we thank you for restoring, Father God, divine health, Lord God, providing all of our need, my Father, Father God, according to your riches and glory. Why, Lord? Because, Lord God, we are now connected to your kingdom. And so, Father God, we just bless you. We praise you, Lord God. We give you glory and honor, might and dominion and power. We thank you, my Father. But, Lord God, it's such a joy to share this wonderful gospel of the kingdom with the people of God. And so, my Father God, we give you thanks, we give you praise, we give you glory and honor, my Father God, again, for this wonderful night. We bless your holy, precious name, and we declare the kingdom of God is coming to the people of God.
You've been listening to a message by Pastor Ezeal McFaul, kingdom citizen and ambassador of Christ. We trust that this message has been a blessing to you, and that in some small way, it has helped you to become more knowledgeable about God's kingdom and his righteousness. It is our prayer that God grants you a heart that hungers and thirsts after his kingdom and his righteousness, so that you will be filled or supplied and begin to experience the abundant life that Christ Jesus came to make available to his children. If you desire further information about our ministry or access to additional resources, please feel free to contact Pastor McFaul at 242-427-5512 or internationally at 954-284-7909. dare to take God at His word, seek His kingdom and His righteousness, be delivered from the spirit of religion, and begin to live life on another level. God bless you is our prayer.
Let the kings worship Him today. Let the kings worship Him.